My name is Acreletae, and I'm here to talk to you about starting off as a dungeon master for Dungeons and Dragons specifically, but I'm sure these skills are transferable for every other role-playing game, tabletop role-playing game, that is. Sorry about that. Go away, Java. I don't want you to update my system. Alright, so, congratulations on this first step to becoming a dungeon master. Okay, so first thing you need to do is find players. That's probably the easiest thing you're gonna have to do. Finding players, what I did was I just made a Facebook status for 6 people to respond, get to play Dungeons and Dragons, and took like 2 hours. Grand, if none of your friends are into that, if you'd be seen as nerdy or weird or kind of awkward or whatever, then be they're losers. You can stick an ad in the paper, you can search online and see if there's already an existing game. Maybe you can get your foot in the door that way. But I recommend starting off with Facebook, it's kind of the easiest thing. Or just, you know, asking friends in person if people still do that. I have no idea. Yeah, so that's number one. Number two then, once you have your players, is choosing a setting. Now you can go down two routes, which is the published campaign setting or the homebrew setting. I'm kind of doing both at the moment, I'm running two campaigns. So published campaign setting would be something like the Forgotten Realms, Eberron, if you're playing 4th edition, which is what I play. And there's some pros and cons involved, so like number one would be like, they've already done the bulk of the work for you. They have maps, they have history, they have culture, they have threats to the whole solar system or just the world or just certain areas. They have everything set out for you. Everything. The only thing is they have like a few blanks here and there for you to invent your own stuff, to customize it, personalize it, tailor it to your players and what they like, which is really, really good. But at the same time, it does limit your creativity somewhat. But, you know, it's pretty good. I'm personally playing the Forgotten Realms. It's alright, I don't really know. It's kind of, I make up most of it, so I don't really listen to the book. So it is quite optional. Homebrew is a lot more work. So unless you have a lot of free time in your hands, I wouldn't even touch it. Because you have to make the maps. You have to put in all the different towns, all the rivers, all the mountains, all the forests. You have to put in the culture, you have to put in history, you have to put in monarchs if you want monarchs, you have to put in the big bad enemy guys, you have to put in the threats, you have to put in everything. All of the legends, all of the myths, all of the things that they could find out about the history of the world, you have to make it all up and have it there ready at your fingertips to hand to them. A lot of work. A lot of fun. If you like telling stories, if you like writing stories, then yeah, go for it if you have the time for it or if you have the patience for it. But, you know, as I said, it is quite time consuming. It's, you know, it's up to yourself, really. After that, you need to get a notebook. It doesn't actually have to be a notebook. It could be like a ring binder or a file on your computer. It doesn't really matter. Personally, I go for notebooks and ring binders. I use them in tandem. But that's just because I write a lot of things down. I don't like typing that much. It hurts my wrists. So first off, we have the ring binder, my personal favourite. Absolutely love this. Is my baby. I've spent hours compiling this, like hours. And like, you know, editing it, moving it around. It's very handy because you don't have to bring it with you anywhere. Like, inspiration will strike you at the most ridiculous moments. All you need is a pen and paper handy. You don't need to bring this with you. It doesn't have to be on your person. Once you have a pen and paper, write it down, stick it in one of these little plastic note pocket things, or just, you know, punch some holes in it and stick it in. And, you know, it's all where it's supposed to be. It's all in order. It's all everything. It's much easier to organize than a notebook. So I have stuff like notes on the last session that we had, just, you know, so I can pick it up easily afterwards. Then after the next divider, I recommend getting a packet of dividers. You'll need them. Then we've got I kind of like a big list of random occurrences for like in a big city. So, you know, guards having, you know, a kerfuffle with a dwarf who's drunk too much ale, things like that. Just, you know, throughout a city or a town or anything, just random stuff. Then in the city we've got recurring NPCs, in this case it's a cook that they're friends with, a maid that they're friends with, some fighters that they've kind of gotten to know, the mayor, things like that. You know, and then we've got information on old festivals, traditions, superstitions, things like that, very useful information. After that we've got like lists of drinks, because you know, it's, you know, in most D&D campaigns it'd be you go into a bar, well, you have, I'll have an ale. In most, like in most real world settings, it'd be like, I'll have an ale. What kind of ale? I mean, like, there's six kinds of ale in this pub alone. Which ones do you want? So we've got new sort of speciality drinks, for example, dwarven meat wine, dragon ale, dragonborn firewater, dwarven hammer and anvil. Like, you can find names all over the internet, because if you're not publishing it for yourself, like, if you're not publishing it for profit or whatever, I don't think it really counts as plagiarism, because it's just you and your mates, you know, having a laugh. I mean, I've had Lemmy from Motorhead turn up as a barge and stuff like that. Like, it doesn't matter, because you're not publishing it, you're not claiming any rights from it, you're not getting any money, just having a laugh, it's grand. After this, so important, a list of NPC names, because it doesn't matter what you're going to do, your players are going to do something you haven't even thought of happening. They have a d20 in their hands, they can do anything with the world. They will do anything with the world. So the least you can do is have a big list of names. So literally male, female, this is the humans, then, like, you know, I've got dwarves, elves, half elves, halflings, things like that, and literally just have big lists of names, so that, you know, if you mention someone in passing, oh, you know, say human female and her son walk past and the son is screaming for sweets, you know, they could go up and talk, they could be like, oh, I'm gonna go and talk to her. Why? I don't know, I'm just gonna talk to her. So they go and talk to her and they find out her name is Hilda. Ta-da. It doesn't take much. So then after that you have, well, I have a list of properties that, like, you know, they were buying a guild house, so I had a few properties for them to need. Then after that I don't really have anything, but, you know, I used to put in like places they've been, names of NPCs they used to be friends with that could pop up anywhere, just little bits and pieces like that. Then you can have things like a notebook. This is for my college D&D group. It's, you know, it's not started yet, but I've got, you know, the whole background written out, kind of their, got their big bad enemy guys set up, I've got the first session planned out, the things that are going to happen, and then I've got a little map of the whole country, which, those of you who know your geography, is actually Chile and Argentina shaped into a dragon fang and made into an island. It's like, you can take it from anywhere, it's really easy to do that. This is the homebrew setting, this is the Forgotten Realm setting. So that's what you do. You need out your big lists, everything else, so literally names, food and drink, random occurrences to happen, and anything else you'd find useful or interesting, magic items that don't come in the books or anything like that, just up to yourself entirely. Next thing you have to do is plan out your threats, because while there is some in the published campaigns, you're going to want to fix it, you're going to want to customize it a bit, tailor it to your characters. I mean, like, I've got one character and he hates the undead, he's a devotee of the Raven Queen and he hates the undead. If there's any mention of the undead, oh, I'm gonna kill them, ah! And then he runs off and he's just gone after the undead. So a lot of my campaign would be against the undead. If he hears of a lich, he's there, like, it doesn't matter what, where he is in the world, he's going to go and kill that lich, because he just hates the undead. And, you know, that's fine, that's how it works out. We've got a paladin, of course, so any mention of bane worship, he's there, you know. So you kind of learn that about your characters and their motivations, and then you just go and, you know, you just give them what they want, really. And then if they're happy, then you're just going to have so much more fun, because they're going to be like, yeah, celebration, the jubilation when they get a crit on the thing that they hate. This is going to be awesome. And then that's all the prep work you need. You're gonna need to give yourself a good bit of time between setting up the group and starting playing. You're gonna if you have a lot of free time, give yourself maybe 2-3 weeks to come up with everything. If you have no free time at all, I'd say give yourself a month and a half. You know, I myself will give myself about 5 weeks or something, because I'm a procrastinator. I'm disorganized. I get stumped very easily. I find it hard to find inspiration sometimes, so I kind of cover all the bases by doing that. Then after that, you plan your first session, and basically while you've been planning the entire world, your players will be planning their characters, their backgrounds, their likes, dislikes, everything else. Get them to send it to you before you start playing. Go through it. If there's anything you don't like, if somebody's being a Mary Sue about it, or they're being, you know, a bit obnoxious or even a bit boring, tell them, you know, I like this about your thing, but, you know, you might want to get rid of this bit altogether. You're not allowed to be forgotten Eladrin royalty. That's a bit much. You know, stuff like that. You want people to be a bit more mundane, whatever. And that's grand. But then your first thing, standard practice would be get them into a tavern all at once, and then, you know, they'll start mingling and mixing and making friends and whatever else, chatting away to each other, and then have a thing. And this thing could be a bar fight, it could be somebody charging in with really sudden alarming news, and that the Lord wants a group of adventurers to come up to the castle or the manor house, wherever, to talk to him, or to, you know, get rid of bandits off the road or something like that. And they'll spot the group of adventurers that have been talking to each other, and they're the only people who are armed in the place, so they get taken in and they're press-ganged into a group together, because that will make them bond together as characters, because they need a valid and believable reason to be adventurers, but also a valid and believable reason to be adventurers together. Like in my first campaign last year, we had a couple of drow, and they didn't like anybody, and they were very unfriendly, and one of them refused to speak to anybody except the other drow, and nobody really understood why they were following everyone else around, if they so hated everybody, if they were worshippers of Lolf, and, you know, nobody really knew why they were there. That kind of thing, it doesn't make any sense to do that kind of thing, so I just not do that. Don't let them do it. If they want to be evil in a good party, you can let them away with that, but they have to be, you know, wanting to overcome this evil core to them and everything else, because otherwise there's no reason for them to be there, none whatsoever, unless, you know, you plot with that character, and then you're, you know, they're in league with the big bad enemy guy, and they're a spy in the midst, and that'd be kind of cool, actually. So, you know, whatever you think yourself. Yeah, that's it. That's all you need to do to start off. Best of luck to you, really, and I'll be posting up another video shortly, probably next week. So, in the meantime, I've been Acreletae, and this has hopefully been helpful.